Things are getting quite worse for us in Latin America, and I think this invasion of Panama means the beginning of a more open war against Latin America. I'm afraid so. I'm not in a very optimistic mood.
Back in the days when we organized in the Black Panther Party, we used to organize tenants. And one of the things we had to overcome was people's belief that the superintendent had a right to do what he was doing to them based on the fact that this was his property. So we used to always tell people that the superintendent or the landlord had no property rights that superseded their human right to decent housing.
Good evening and welcome to Dead Air Live. Tonight's show is called Video as a Weapon in the Hands of the People. And tonight we'll be looking at four tapes that have been produced this year. We've chosen to call tonight's show Video as a Weapon because we'd like to highlight something that very often is hidden or obscured by both television and the mass media in general. And that is that, in fact, television and video are systematically used as weapons against us. Not only in the way of subtly producing stereotypes or distorting history, but also in very direct and concrete ways. Two examples from this summer illustrate this. The first is the use of video by state surveillance agency to arrest and eventually bring down the mayor of Washington, D.C., Marion Barry, and also the use of video by the New York City Police Department to force confessions from a group of African-American youth who had been arrested in the so-called Central Park rape case. Now, the fact that in both cases it was the video image more than anything else that proved to be an effective weapon by the state suggests that this is, of course, a very important subject. But something that's been lost in the coverage of the mass media is the ways in which video has also increasingly become a weapon in the hands of the people in a whole variety of organizing efforts and struggles. During this past period, there have been hundreds, probably thousands of tapes produced by activists on a grassroots basis who are trying to educate, inform, or organize in a particular setting. And because video is something that is easy to learn, and because of the vast number of local public access centers where training is given freely, what we have seen bloom in the past decade is a movement of video activism, a movement that poses a profoundly democratic medium on the grassroots in place of what is clearly a totalitarian use of video by the state. In fact, where the state and the large media empires are highly concentrated at the top, the new video activist movement has power at the base. Tonight we're going to look at four tapes, and they're only an example of a vast number of tapes that are being produced, but we think that they will show different aspects of the work that's being produced today. The first tape that we're going to look at is called Takeover, and it documents a series of takeovers by housing activists and homeless people around the country on May 1st of this year. It was produced in one of the first nationally coordinated efforts by video activists to show people what in fact occurred on May 1st, 1990. You'll notice on the excerpt that we're watching that a time code, a sort of stopwatch counter, is running at the base of the tape, and that is because the tape is still not completed, but the makers are very, very encouraging that we make use of it immediately. And so tonight we're going to begin by sharing with you a scene from Takeover, and after that we're going to look at three other videos that have also been produced this year and that also form a part of what we're going to call the new video activism. One word about the tape that we're about to see as well is that it's a short excerpt, about 15 minutes, from a tape that will run an hour when completed. And because of this, some of the important historical context is not there. but we do hope that the tape leads you to inquire further, and also that at some point the television stations themselves might consider showing it. So to begin with tonight, we'll watch a show called Takeover, produced on May Day.
More and more poor people in fewer affordable houses. There are houses out there, and they're rightfully ours. This is our government, and those houses are our houses.
Hard is the crook! Hard is the crook!
We just have to take them.
Hard is the crook! Hard is the crook! Hard is the crook! Hard is the
crime scene! Crime scene! Crime scene! Crime scene! Crime scene! Crime scene!
Go ahead, y'all got the floor.
301 Wadsworth is the nicest HUD house I have ever seen.
Out of the bunch.
It's not even boarded up. We went in there today and took a look. There's a sunken living room with functional fireplace.
Love it.
On the second floor, there are three bedrooms. The average size is bigger than the room you're in now.
So basically the property is livable. The sound, and it's livable.
Right now.
It's ready.
It's an awesome house.
Okay, now I'm quite sure that there's going to be a lot of opposition around you, I think so.
When we entered the block, there was a guy walking up the street with his dog.
Okay.
This guy, he's Preppyville, put it that way. So by now, the word is out.
Oh boy. Do we go in tonight?
Let's say we go in there tonight, right? Some of us, let's select who goes in there, but we still got to be at the shelter tomorrow because we still got folks lined up to give us support and da 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 da. We it's like people are building up anticipation for tomorrow, right? Mm-hmm. So if we just go in there tonight and don't go down there and communicate with our support group and stuff like that, then we might lose.
Well, one of the things that we're not going to do is send all of the leadership in there tonight.
Okay.
Everybody don't need to go.
If this star baby belonged to Deanna, who is my 5-year-old, her name probably would be Kathy. The only thing that would make me leave my baby's star baby, you know, I'm just guessing, is that the mom, and the mom, you know, said I had to just grab my children and run for our life. Melissa slept right there. You know, this is Melissa's bed right here, you know? And these are Melissa's reading awards. If Kathy belonged to Deanna, no matter where we was at, she would be in pain. And she'd be fretful and throwing tangents because it's like I made her leave her baby. You know, it's like me leaving my baby. You know, that's what this baby would mean to the average little girl. And I don't think she willingly left her baby. You know, I think that they were forced. And I know they were forced out of here by HUD, but I don't know who else forced them out. You sit right here, Kathy. I'm gonna find you a little mommy.
Hi there, can I have the news desk?
Okay, I'll tell you the story. We are the National Union of the Homeless, and we're taking HUD houses again today, all over Mount Airy. Okay, location number one is 301 Wadsworth. We are in that house now, and we're not moving until the federal marshals come and get us.
Wave the flag on the 4th of July and celebrate Veterans Day. And this is what their country do to them.
Black family, yeah.
They throw them away just like that.
Yeah, and I think, you know, once people can begin to realize the power that we have, we can turn this country upside down. Because it's more of us than it is than poverty.
We're staying in this house at 301 Wadsworth until the federal marshals come and take us out.
I think it's going to be a revolution of poor people. You know, because we cannot separate or isolate ourselves in terms of poverty. When you're poor, you're poor. You know, homelessness is just the bottom of the barrel. Okay, you can't go no further than that. But you got people, you got the working class people who are suffering almost as bad as we are.
All right. I'll get the hell out of the way. Nyla's gonna get a house today. And all of us are gonna see to it that she does.
All right. Go ahead. Speech.
Just say I'm gonna get a house. No?
Yeah. No.
She doesn't want to talk right now.
Get the show on the road. To move on this housing. Let's take over the houses now. The heck with all the rest of the speeches. Let's get started taking care of business. Let's get the show on the road. So we're not people, we're not human beings too.
Seven brothers and sisters. We'd do everything. So I had to be mostly the mother of my whole family. I had just turned 15 when I had Tina. So I was a pretty young mother.
Don't tell me. It looks like the
what I am is a homeless mother.
We're gonna have to go get some fuses.
And I don't ever want to be homeless again.
Fusers. Okay.
Oh, we didn't get that fixed.
Hey, there.
It's a place we can call home. Ain't no perfect.
This is my home. This is my home right here.
No housing!
No peace!
What do we want?
Housing!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Housing!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Housing!
When do we want it?
Now!
At least 200 of these in the city of New Site are sitting empty right now. The active price is up sky high so that poor and homeless people can't afford to buy a house like this. And then as soon as it sets on the market for a couple of months and nobody buys it, then they come in real quick and they lower the price and they have an auction. They take bids for like 2 weeks. Bang, they come in and they sell this piece of property and they sell it right underneath people like you and me that could use a house like this. It's not a fancy house, but it's a house. It's better than sleeping underneath the bushes out there in the street. And it's better than having somebody hit you in the head with a brick and try to kill you. I say we live here, you know? I'm gonna live here.
I'm gonna live here.
Yeah.
This
was been planned for a long time, and this was the day. All of us was not only celebrating the unity of everybody in Thompson Square Car Park, but an anticipation of the housing takeover.
It's on 9th Street between C and D.
The reason why we're doing it now is because our friends, which we weren't sure of in the past, became our brothers in this action. Their job was to distract the police while we took houses. Unfortunately, the price they paid for us taking these buildings was more than we looked for.
Get more hands out here.
Watch your hand.
While we were taking housing, the job of the people in the park was to distract the police. Unfortunately, the police had an ulterior motive in mind. Their job was to kick butt.
Jumping off at the park.
The band.
No, I'm talking about heat.
I know.
Police
are
racing over here.
Get the band.
Now, I was just going out of the park, okay, to get some help, and the cop told me, bam, right in my motherfucking face. It's time for war. We gonna fucking fight now because of the fact that they fucking started it, and we ain't gonna end this shit until the fucking pigs get out.
No housing, no pigs.
Okay. Welcome back to the studio. I should mention that the tape that we've just seen, Takeover, having been filmed by activists in half a dozen cities, is now also being used, even in rough cut version, by those same activists. The actions themselves, the May Day Day of Actions, had been planned after a national march in Washington by homeless organizers and people demanding that HUD in Washington make available some of the many, many thousands of abandoned properties which it owns. And what Jack Kemp, the then secretary of HUD, stated was that homeless people would be given 10% of all of those abandoned houses. Housing activists then in the National Union of Homelessness decided to organize to take some of those houses. The next tape that we're going to be seeing was filmed 4 months before the May Day tape. And it was filmed less than a month after the U.S. military invaded and occupied Panama City. Now, you remember the context at that time. After the United States invaded Panama at Christmas time, no media whatsoever was allowed to report for the first 3 days. And after that, all that we learned was from the U.S. military command headquarters. And so most of what was happening in Panama City at that time was not known to people around the world. Well, two young filmmakers, one of them a Panamanian and another North American, decided to try and bring to us some voices from the Panamanian people. And the next tape we're going to watch is called Panama City. It was filmed in January of 1990, and it brings us voices from people in Panama that we still would never have heard from the major network stations. We're going to look at a tape that was filmed using the new Video 8 technology and that was secretly filmed in Panama, the tapes having been snuck in and then taken out, disguised as audio cassettes. The tape also here that we're watching is an earlier version of a tape that's continually being updated as information in Panama develops. So now with a tape called Panama City, Voices of the Panamanian Underground, we'll go to a tape.
Things are getting quite worse for us in Latin America, and I think this invasion of Panama means the beginning of a more open war against Latin America. I'm afraid so. I'm not in a very optimistic mood.
Un ejército de ocupación que hoy día está aprovechándose del desconcierto y aprovechándose de la confusión que reina en muchos sectores populares por la situación anormal que se vivía internamente, cosa que fue utilizada como pretexto. Noriega fue el pretexto. Peores hombres criminales de verdad han sido no solamente aupados por los Estados Unidos, sino que defendidos, ¿verdad?, porque representan sus intereses.
Una de las cuestiones que más me impresionó fue que cuando entré a la parte del estadio, lo primero que me pegó fue el olor de la marihuana. Entonces habían grupos fumando marihuana abiertamente y había gente cogiendo cocaína en las gradas del estadio ese, de la escuela de Balboa. Cuando me fui involucrando con esa gente, los damnificados y los que habían salido de la cárcel, me di cuenta de que ellos salían durante el día a buscar las drogas, a saquear en la ciudad y después regresaban con las bolsas y hacían una especie de mercado, ¿no?, donde se vendía de todo. Se vendía de todo, desde ropa, comida, lo que fuera, lo que uno quisiera conseguir. Producto del saqueo, además de las drogas. Y hay una cuestión que es paradójica, ¿no?, que el mismo ejército que supuestamente había venido a capturar a Noriega, a detener a Noriega por narcotraficantes, muchos de ellos eran clientes de estas personas que salían a buscar la cocaína y la marihuana.
Ese momento que estamos capturados, yo me di cuenta que quizás lo hice y no tenía por qué hacerlo, de enfrentarme en ese momento a los norteamericanos. Vi, sin embargo, a los llamados lumpen, que estos sí no le importaba absolutamente nada con los norteamericanos, y cuando ellos veían que estaban encerrados, veían la hora y estaban completamente, ¿no?, inconformes. Y les gritaban a los norteamericanos, desgraciado, hijo de puta, suéltame de aquí, yo no tengo nada que ver con esta cuestión de política, pero tú tienes que soltarme, este es mi país, hijo de puta. Les repetían, quítate esa arma, para ver si tú eres hombre, ven, vamos a valernos con las manos, para ver si tú eres hombre. Entonces a mí me llamó mucho la atención eso, no porque yo sentía también la necesidad de protestar, pero yo no podía hacerlo, ¿no? Pero a través de ese lumpen, como que me sentí tranquilo de que había por lo menos alguien que en nombre de todo un pueblo panameño, ¿verdad? Porque es mentira que todo el pueblo panameño está a favor de esta intervención norteamericana. Es lógico que cuando tenemos una 38 en la nuca, nosotros no podemos hablar, ¿no? Y eso es lo que está sucediendo en Panamá. Estamos con un 38 en la nuca y no podemos hablar. Pero si estuviéramos en condiciones normales realmente, aquí lo habríamos... Habríamos mucho que saldríamos a protestar por esta intervención.
It's just like a toothache. You know about it, you can talk about it. You remember you had a toothache 2 years ago. You know that you're going to have a toothache in the future, but you don't know what a toothache unless you have it in that moment. Something you cannot imagine, you cannot think about it unless you have it in that moment. Well, we all knew that to see American soldiers on the streets was going to be something painful. We all knew that happened in Santo Domingo. We all knew that these things happened, but we didn't believe it, and we didn't know how strong it is until we saw it. So, as I said, it's like a toothache. Unless you have it in that moment, you cannot talk about it because it's beyond imagination.
Pues la gente te ve que yo le digo adiós y en el fondo, coño, le estoy diciendo hasta de que se van a morir, o sea, eso se está dando. Mucha gente lo saluda para salvarse el pellejo. La gente teme, son niños muy jóvenes. Mire, yo hablé con un soldado negro norteamericano, que yo le comenté a él que a mí no me había gustado que ellos habían hecho mi país. Y él me dijo que entendiera que ese era su trabajo y que a él tampoco le había gustado. Y que le gustaba que yo le dijera eso, porque era, porque poca gente se atrevía a decir eso. Él me dijo, a mí no me ha gustado hacer eso. Eso me ha hecho sufrir mucho, me dijo él. Y eso me gustó. Y como ese, ahí norteamericanos te encuentras en la calle y cuando tú le dices eso, te dice, lo siento, I'm sorry. O sea, ellos mismos no están de acuerdo. Esos muchachos, ¿qué más quisieran estar en una discoteca ahorita? O sea, ellos se veían nerviosos. Ellos hicieron cantidad de, mataron gente, pelados, inexpertos también, quién sabe, ellos no querían. Yo estoy segura que esos muchachos por decisión propia no. Es un ejército que te envíe, que una orden de esta gente los mandaron a asesinar un pueblo. Ellos también van traumados de aquí. Yo pienso que ellos también van traumados de aquí. Lo que importa es la minoría con criterio, que esa minoría con criterio tenga una mayoría dentro de ellos, que entienda, coño, que esto fue un error, que esto es una de las estupideces más del imperio, y que el imperio, mientras más estupidez está cometiendo, más, cada día se está hundiendo más. Porque a la larga, no ahora, tal vez 10, 20 años, 30, lo que fuese, esto le va a costar al imperialismo yanqui. Estoy partida, Cheche. O sea, tú me decías que tú me veías muy positiva, lo que sea. Uno tiene que tener, tengo que tener mi fuerza, ¿no? Es algo, pero yo estoy destruida por dentro. Yo jamás voy a olvidar esto.
The fact of having invaded Panama, it's something that will never go away. It will always be true. It will always, for the eternity, it will always be true that 20th of December 1989, they invaded Panama. That's going to remain, and that's going to have an effect, constant. From then on, we know that the moment we don't behave, the moment we don't do anything at all, the moment we kill an American that didn't stop, where he had to stop and was killed by a guard, we have 5,000-7,000 people killed. In history, things do not happen the moment they happen. In history, things happen, and what actually happened, you know what actually happened years afterwards, So we know something very, very bad happened, but we don't know how bad. I suspect even of the destruction of the Panamanian nationality. That's impossible.
Ya conocemos, ¿verdad?, que el lobo está en nuestras casas y la solidaridad tiene que cambiar también. Hasta ahora en este país había realizado una extraordinaria campaña de solidaridad con Nicaragua, en algún tiempo con Cuba, ahora posteriormente con la lucha del pueblo salvadoreño por su liberación. La solidaridad por Panamá, a raíz de este hecho y de ocupación de nuestro Panamá, tendrá que redoblarse. Ya en la ciudad de Panamá, antes del 9 de enero de este año de 1990, han aparecido en las principales calles de la ciudad letreros con nuevas y frescas consignas en el sentido de que la lucha continúa.
In Panama, the oligarchy does not need a national army to defend its interests, because it has the American army right next door, so they don't need a national army. All they need is a police corps in order to protect their properties. I mean, they need a police corps like they need dogs to bark at night when the poor people want to rob them. So that's what they want. They want only a police corps. And they don't want an army because they don't need it. They already have one, and a very powerful one. No? Whenever they needed an army, like they did, for example, in 1925, they just, well, not telephone, I don't know if they had telephones in those days, but they just called the American army, and the American came in, just like now, exactly like now. For example, let me say this, because I want to say, in the October 3rd, there was almost a coup here, and Arias Calderón, which is right now the first vice president, but actually he's the president. Actually, he's the one that has the brain and the political ability and malignity to go to be in power right now. Well, he not only he 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 not only wanted an intervention, he got mad at the Americans because they did not intervene. He insulted them. He told them, you are like dogs that bark but do not bite. And he did it. I saw it on the television. He had this awful face. He was really mad with them because they did not invade. So I'm talking about the difference between the intervention now and 1925, when they asked the intervention and they got it. But now they did not only ask for the intervention, they got mad when they didn't get it the moment they wanted. Now I suppose he's happy. Now I suppose he's convinced that the American dogs bite besides bark, no? But anyway, so that's the reason why, let me finish this, that's the reason why they don't want an army, because they don't need it. But on the other hand, the Americans, they want to have an army here, an army at their image, of course, and in favor of their interest, because the Americans need to have a beautiful face in front of the international community. And they need a Panamanian army for them to do the nasty work, the dirty work, the repression, the torture, the killings that they do not, that they can't do them by themselves. If I have to ask for something immediately, no? Of course, I'm not going to ask a revolution. I'm not going to ask for social laws for the people. The thing I would ask for them immediately is for them to go away. I don't want to see them in the streets. I don't want to see them in the streets. Because we have right now an occupation. After the invasion came an occupation. We have a military occupation. And I think that the most important thing, if we have to ask for solidarity, if we have to ask people, like the one you're going to show this thing, what do we want them to do for us, is to ask for them to leave the country immediately. So as possible.
Welcome back to the studio. The tape we just saw shares some discussions with us from January in Panama City. Since then, we've learned, of course, that more than 5,000 people may have been killed in the attack, and more than 10,000 families have been made homeless. The next tape that we're going to watch is called Framing the Panthers in Black and White. And this tape tells the story of COINTELPRO, the FBI's counterintelligence program, which sought to destroy many of the popular organizations of the 1960s, including the Black Panther Party. The film focuses on Daruba bin Wahad, a member of the Black Panther Party who was wrongly arrested and convicted more than 19 years ago and was freed only this summer. This tape is now being circulated nationally, and we are sharing a small excerpt from it. It's called Framing the Panthers in Black and White.
Because of the violent actions of the leadership of the New Left, FBI officials concluded that some additional effort must be made to neutralize and disrupt this revolutionary movement.
The FBI always publicly maintains that the purpose of COINTELPRO was to prevent violence. But COINTELPRO itself was an exceedingly violent program. Law enforcement agencies throughout the country, with the FBI, raided numerous offices of the Black Panther Party. Fred Hampton and Mark Clark, Black Panther Party leaders in Chicago, were murdered while they slept in their beds. In the split in the party, which the FBI caused and which forced Daruba to go underground, that split resulted in factional violence leading to the deaths of many members of the Black Panther Party. And in this document, we see that the FBI actually takes credit for the death of Robert Webb, who was killed during factional violence in March of 1971.
There was nothing haphazard or incidental about COINTELPRO, okay? And when we read the documents, we'll see that J. Edgar Hoover talks about the former FBI director, J. Edgar Hoover. He talks about the standards of moral conduct that hold sway in the African-American community. Being a racist, he says that these standards are essentially low-life standards, and they're different than white standards, you see? you know, they're not like us. And it's the same thing they did to the Vietnamese people. We see that historically, going back to the Vietnam War, a lot of police officers got their initial training in counterinsurgency and counterintelligence in Vietnam. See, these techniques were brought home, the war was brought home to the United States. And when we used to say that they were bringing, that the war was being fought in our community at home, the peace movement, which was predominantly white, which was predominantly liberal, ignored us. They didn't want to confront and deal with their racism. It was all right to talk about stop the war in Vietnam because that threatened their future, you see. They would be the ones to be drafted. Okay? They didn't want to deal with the war in Harlem. They didn't want to deal with the war in Watts. They didn't want to deal with the war in Buttermilk Bottom in Atlanta. They didn't want to deal with the war on Hastings Street in Detroit. They didn't want to deal with that. You see? Because that was too close to home.
There are over 4,500 guns in this collection. All of the weapons are in very good working condition. They're not simply for display, because the agents will use some of the weapons for test firing and also for interchangeable parts.
And a result of the violence in the party and the confusion, many members of the Black Panther Party had to go underground, Daruba being one of them. And some of them who went underground had charges against them. They were forced into a situation of living underground, and then local police and the FBI embarked upon what were in reality search and destroy missions, hunting down missing Panthers on the street, many of whom were shot and killed in confrontations with the police.
The first thing you have to do in order to impress a people, to repress them, is to denigrate their humanity. Reduce them to something less than human. Make them into an other, a threatening other. Then you can do anything you wanted to them. You can lock them up and put them in prison like they did me. You could murder them like they did Fred Hampton and Mark Clark, or Twyman Myers, or Zaid Malik Shakur. Or you could exile them like they did Michael Tabor or Asada Shakur. You see? That's what the system does. It first strips you of your humanity, reduces you to the level of a mad dog and a depraved terrorist, and then it's open season on you. They can do anything they want to you.
My name is Damian King, and I'm a junior at Martin Luther King High School.
Were you ever taught about the Panthers in school?
No.
But what about in a history class, for instance?
No.
No. And do you think you should be taught about the Panthers in school?
Yes. Because it's all part of history, so why shouldn't we be taught about it?
His conviction was overturned last Thursday, and today they're issuing a bail hearing to determine if he will be released on his own recognizance after 19 years of imprisonment. We just saw Daruba go by in a Department of Corrections van, so we know he will be upstairs at that time.
How do you account for these delays?
Well, it's really bizarre to me because during my husband's incarceration, he's been subjected to very close security, and on his last couple of trials he's been brought down here. Helicopters were circling the courthouse to give the appearance that he was some sort of great terrorist and threat to the community. He's an asset to the African-American community. I think this is just a strategy on the part of the courts to make sure that people do not come out in full force and support him.
The time served by the defendant says the judgment in this case. The court at this time, pursuant to CPL Article 510, issues a securing order releasing defendant on his own recognizance.
Thank you.
That's 1114 Forest Avenue. I guess it would be presumptuous to knock on the door and ask the people how long they lived there.
So this is where you grew up, this neighborhood?
The street.
Yeah.
The street.
So you still have family in the neighborhood?
No. I don't know nobody here anymore. It used to be the Ministry of Information used to be right down Boston Road, right off 169th Street. Look at this, man. Blow it up. Well, landlords still as foul as they were before, huh? Well, maybe we could do something about a rent strike. Back in the days when we organized in the Black Panther Party, we used to organize tenants. And one of the things we had to overcome was people's belief that the superintendent had a right to do what he was doing to them based on the fact that this was his property. So we used to always tell people that the superintendent or the landlord had no property rights that superseded their human right to decent housing. And that was very difficult to get people to understand. That used to be the Black Panther Party's East Coast Ministry of Information, right next to those burned out buildings and vacant lot. Like most things, I guess that's gone. You can create that type of environment. I mean, you don't need the police to do that.
But it's gotta be the people.
Exactly. Police travel up and down this way all the time, you know. But when you see the end results of what they do, see, I've seen the end results of what they do. See, I've been upstate and seen the end results of what happens to these kids they snatch up off the streets. I've seen how they take black children and what they turn them into, okay? So you only see the beginning of this because you're only dealing with your little world right here.
I was born by the river.
See, I've seen the end results of what they do. See, I've been upstate.
The river I've been running.
This is an excerpt from a letter I received from my husband, Aruba, dated September 7th, 1989. I'm tired of being tired, and winters are the loneliest and worst time in prison. I remember the feeling of being up north in Clinton or Attica during the winter, so far away from the source of any care or love or warmth. Not that anybody really loved me during those harsh, bitter times. In Clinton, it's on a mountain. It was so cold that your hair would freeze, and the long, heated corridors of that dismal place made you feel like you were underground. Clinton County is one of the poorest in the state, so it is always getting a new prison. Its major growth industry is the traffic in black and Latino flesh.
Coming home. Said, Daruba, ever since I met you 15 years ago, you've been getting out of prison. I said, you know something, Liz? You're right. Every year I was coming home. And this year I did. We have over 100 political prisoners who remain in prison today. And their day has to come. And their day will come when we make it come.
Once again, welcome back to the studio. Daruba bin Wahad spent 19 years as a political prisoner in prison, and most of us had never known of his name. The next tape that we're about to watch, the last tonight, is called Stop the Church. And the tape documents the organizing by ACT UP, the AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power in New York City, their organizing efforts for a demonstration last December at the Cathedral of Cardinal O'Connor. The tape is important for several reasons, but the most interesting to us is that this this event, which clearly was a very important organizing event in New York City, was not covered at all by the major networks. It's also worth pointing out that ACT UP is now an international movement, and this tape is being used in Europe as well as in the United States. We'll go now to an excerpt from the tape, Stop the Church.
I'd like to do something inside. So, I mean, I think you're right. It is general knowledge, and they expect us to be inside. You know, they probably expect us to be as clever as we are. You know, and I think that they will be edgy and looking as they let people in 20 minutes before the mass starts.
What I care about is making sure that David Dinkins doesn't listen to him, the city council doesn't listen to him, the Board of Education doesn't listen to him, and that he loses his political power in the city. And therefore, I don't think it's so crucial to confront him inside or the parishioners.
I'm 1,000% opposed to anything to go on inside, because that violates the whole thing we're fighting for, and that's freedom of speech. We wouldn't want them busting into an ACT UP meeting and celebrating mass in the middle of it.
ACT UP has never been, and I hope will never be, an organization that runs from the power that it is opposing and from the power that it has taken an issue with. We are taking an issue with Cardinal O'Connor, and that church is his house. He has pretty much said it. He has been quoted as, I could keep anybody out that I want to. Try it, Cardinal O'Connor. Try keeping my life out of your church.
The history of hate phone calls or death threats to ACT UP, we've gotten very, very few. It's usually like once every 6 months. But just to show you how daring this action is, our death threats are now running a couple a day. And they're pretty vile.
They're very ugly.
They're very ugly. We're keeping recordings of all of them in case they become true. Just so you know, we're getting some people agitated.
Cardinal O'Connor yesterday urged followers to react calmly to a planned demonstration by AIDS and abortion activists at St. Patrick's Cathedral that is expected to draw more than 5,000 people.
If they make us stay a block away, it's just such an incredible statement that they're so afraid of what we have to say that they're going to fortify the place. I mean, we win at that point.
It's going to be really nasty. Let's be honest with ourselves. They're importing cops from Queens. They're coming to guard their cathedral.
Four areas in the mass where all of us can respond to. The first is what I call the prelude, when the organist is playing the organ as the church is being evacuated and the next mass is coming in. This is a very good opportunity for us to get out our printed information in the form of a false St. Patrick's Cathedral program. We do not challenge anybody's right to worship, so that's right up front. But then it goes on basically with our complaints. It's our fact sheet. We feel that the strongest thing we can do is something in silence, a mass in die-in that occurs two minutes after he opens up his mouth, up along the central nave and the portion right before the altar. Okay, we want to deflect attention away from the pulpit. We want the parishioners to make the noises. We want the parishioners to think they're looking at an epiphany.
I just want to suggest that, have you considered that while you're doing the diet, everyone be chanting? If you're being carried out, be chanting. Why not?
We communicate through the media, not to the media. Use the media to get our message to the people whose attention we have grabbed with our event. Use this as an opportunity to communicate, to build our numbers bigger and stronger. Give them reasons to join us, to support us, to destroy the power of the Catholic Church, to make our side the strong one. And to do that, we must put out the message that we are the ones who are fighting for people's lives, and they are the murderers.
Abortion, isn't it?
Yeah, and AIDS.
And AIDS, well.
What are they doing?
What would have the AIDS have to do with it?
Welcome back. Stop the Church was the last of our video excerpts on tonight's show. And if you wanted to get information on any of the four tapes, I'd encourage you to grab a pen and paper because information will be coming up in a minute. In the meantime, I hope that tonight's show, Video as a Weapon, has shown that not only is the video activist movement alive and well, but that there are a depth and breadth of actions and struggles in this country that the mass media never records, and that only we can rely on ourselves to learn about. Thanks again, and good night.
Panama means the beginning of a more open war against Latin America. I'm afraid so. I'm not in a very optimistic mood.
Back in the days when we organized in the Black Panther Party, we used to organize tenants. And one of the things we had to overcome was people's belief that the superintendent had a right to do what he was doing to them, based on the fact that this was his property. So we used to always tell people that The superintendent or the landlord had no property rights that superseded their human right to decent housing.
Large part of the task of the media is simply to direct people away from issues, so keep them focused on sitcoms and, you know, spectator sports or something, anything, as long as they don't get involved in something that might be serious.
And another reason why we decided to take bicycles was to see at a grassroots level what sort of destruction was going on, how the people were living in the forest, what they thought of the forest, and to see it in a level that was not necessarily through the eyes of corporate businesses.
The situation in Nicaragua got worse and worse through the 60s, and in the late 60s and in the early 70s, there began to be a response, an organized effort on the part of many different sectors of Nicaraguan society to resist the violence of the dictatorship.
And what was particularly exciting about this march here in the Boston area was not just the numbers of people, although we were able to send down from eastern Massachusetts over 15,000 people alone.
Tonight, we'll be looking at a number of tapes from the Somerville Producers Group tape archive. We do these shows every now and then for your enjoyment, and tonight is one of those times.
Think again, or you'll get something you'll remember.